Morning, everyone. Good morning and welcome to worship here this morning on this fourth Sunday of October. A few announcements for us today. I want to invite all of you to sign in on the fellowship pad to let us know that you're here with us in worship today. If you have any contact information you'd like to pass along to the office or any information, you can do so on the fellowship pad. It has the red cover beside you, in front of you, near you. Let us know that you're here with us in worship today. I want to thank everyone that helped with our story walk yesterday, many, many helpers for that event. This coming week, we continue with our Wednesday evening children and youth ministries. Kingdom Kids meets at 5 p.m. here downstairs in the Youth Lounge and Fellowship Hall area, and Youth Group begins at 6:15. Our deacons are going to meet Wednesday evening at 7 p.m. also. And with more information on some an upcoming youth event is Sherry to tell us more about Trunk or Treat coming up next Sunday.
So our Trunk or Treat event is next Sunday from 2 to 4 p.m. We are still in the need of some folks to host games from their trunk. I'm praying the Lord would give us four more. Right now we have six. So if you are able to use your trunk and do a game from the back of it, if you need an idea for a game or you need a game itself, I can give you that. So please let me know if you're able to do that. We are also still in need of some candy donations, and we're collecting those in the church office. Otherwise, there are also some colorful flyers in the office that I'd appreciate if you would pass those to any families you think would have kids who could enjoy this. So hope to see you guys there.
Okay. Thanks, Sherry. Next announcement for us. Lucy's here, everybody. I don't know if you got that. Frienda Edwards has some information about what's coming up in 2 weeks when we turn our clocks back to return to standard time. We're going to celebrate the sacrament of the Lord's Supper in our worship that day, and what else?
I don't know.
Okay. Hit it, Forrest.
One day at a time.
That's right.
But one day at a time, but we do have to plan ahead. In 2 weeks, that's the 6th, is our soup sale. We need everybody to make the soup, and you donate the soup, and then we sell the soup, and really we sort of sell it back to you. it's sort of a fun fundraiser. The soup containers are here, and there are also some in the office. You can bring it back like Thursday or Friday before the soup sale, anytime the church office is open, and just take it down and put it in the refrigerator. On Saturday, I will be here from 10 to 12 to collect it, and then the soup is sold after both services on the 6th. It costs $7. There will also be very good bread that goes with the soup. All the money that we make on the soup sale goes to buy Christmas presents for needy children, and that's through the Operation Christmas. What is it?
Holiday Helping Hands.
Holiday Helping Hands. Which we'll be getting cards when?
Soon.
We'll be getting
before Thanksgiving.
Okay. We're going to get those cards soon. Those are the ones that tell us the children, their age, boy, and their needs and their wants. But anyhow, all the money that we make on the soup sale allows us to buy, usually we take a large family of children, and we're able to buy their needs and their wants. So if we don't have a large family, then we take several children. So that, but all the soup sale goes to needy children. And the second thing is our shoebox. That's also going on. And these are due on the 13th. So we have an extra week for those. The boxes are available here and in the library. You fill them up. It now costs $10 in postage to send them. Again, inflation. What we ask that you do is when you bring your box back filled, the $10
if you make the checkout to the Presbyterian women, because when we turn the boxes in, then we just give them one check. If you have any questions about how to fill this up or you don't think you can do it, I will do your shopping for you if you wish. Both of these projects really get us into the Christmas spirit, and what's better than getting into the Christmas spirit? Thank you. Oh, when you return your box, just put it in the lounge. Okay? We all work together. When you bring it back, you put it in the lounge, which is across from the church office. Okay?
Okay.
Okay?
Okay. Okay.
With all that, let us prepare our hearts for the worship of the living God.
Please join me in the call to worship that's printed in your bulletin, and it's taken from Psalm 84. How lovely is your dwelling place, Lord Almighty.
My soul yearns, even faints, for the courts of the Lord.
My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God.
There is one day in your courts and a thousand elsewhere.
I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of the wicked. Lord Almighty, blessed is the one who trusts in you. Please join me in prayer. Good morning, God. On this beautiful fall Sunday morning, we're happy to be in your house to worship you and hear your word and sing songs of praise. We are fortunate that we live in a country where this is possible, but too often, people don't want to spend even an hour with you, preferring instead to engage in activities of this world. Be with us this morning, helping us to remember what we've heard and guide us to live in a way that is pleasing to you. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Please rise for hymn number 323, Holy, Holy, Holy.
Thank you.
Please join me in affirming our faith with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead.
I believe in the
Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please join in the prayer of confession. God, be merciful to me, a sinner in the company of sinners. Too often we hide behind the veil of religion or trust in the good things we do. Seemingly safe in our pews, we look down on those not here, thankful we are not like them. Yet the truth is, we have all sinned. We have all fallen short of the people you call us to be. Cleanse us and restore us for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Savior. We pray in his name. Amen. Hear the good news. The saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance that Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross so that we might be dead to sin and alive to all that is good. I declare to you this day, in the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Amen.
Be seated. I invite our children to come forward for our children's time this morning.
Good morning, guys. How are you today? Good, good. I wonder, has there ever been a time when you got separated from mom or dad when you're out with them? That can be a little bit scary depending on where you are, right? If not that, there's also times when we have to separate from our parents, right? When we go to school, or maybe we go to a sleepover or a party. Yeah, and so the thing is, sometimes we get separated from our parents, and sometimes that makes us feel a little bit nervous or scared. But there's one person that we never are separated from. Who's that? God, that's right. He is with us wherever we go, whatever we do. Listen to this from God's word. It says, "For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth." That's a lot of things, right? "Nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord." So, you know what? At times when we have to separate from mom or dad, what can we always remember? Who is always with us? Yeah? God is. That's right. Nothing and nobody can separate us from him. So we can always be assured that he is with us and that he's taking care of us. Let's just pray and thank him for that, okay? Lord Jesus, thank you so much that your word tells us that nothing and no one can separate us from you. Lord, help us to remember that and to have peace and trust in you. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, guys, you are invited down to Children's Church.
I want to read the whole Bible.
Thank you, choir. As we enter into our prayer time here for this morning, we want to pray for Jim Gilligan. He had successful knee replacement surgery this past Wednesday and is recovering at home. We want to continue to pray for him and for his recovery. Prayers today for Richard Mort and his family. Richard's at Juniper Village in Monroeville and is in the final days of a battle with dementia. So I want to pray for Richard and his family, and continued prayers for our world as well. Let us come before the Lord here in prayer together. We praise you, O God, of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, for the beauty of this day and of your creation. We thank you. We praise you, O God, that you are always with us and that you will never leave us, that you have come to us in the person of the Son, Jesus Christ, that you remain with us in the person of the Holy Spirit. We pray, O God, that you would speak that truth into our hearts this day once again. As we pray together today, we lift up to you the work that you have set before us, and we pray your blessing upon everything from trunk or treat next Sunday to our soup sale coming up to shoeboxes that will go to the ends of the earth. We pray that you would continue to strengthen us as we live and proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ in all that we do. In our own lives, here in this week to come, we pray individually that, Lord, that you would give us the courage to speak our faith to someone who needs to know you. Pray that you would place on our hearts just one person that needs to hear your good news this week, Lord Jesus. As we pray together today, we praise you that you're a God of healing, that you're a God of mercy. And we pray for healing today for Jim Gilligan as he recovers from knee replacement surgery. Ask that you would give him patience and strength. We pray for Richard Mort and his family at this time, Lord, that they may know your comfort and your peace. For others in need of your healing, O God, we lift them up before you. Those names and circumstances listed in our bulletin, may we be mindful of those needs in this week. As we pray together, O God, we ask that you would quiet our hearts now as we come before you in a few moments of silent prayer. Hear our prayers, O God. We pray this day that you would bring peace into your world. We pray that where there is conflict, that there may be peace. For lives that have been overturned by natural disaster and man-made disaster, we pray, O God, that you would bring peace. And may the truth of your salvation that has come in Jesus Christ bring hope to them. Lord, we pray especially for the Ukraine, that there may be peace in that land, and for their leaders in the Ukraine and Russia, that they may come to terms of peace. We pray in our own lives, O God, that we may be instruments of your peace. We praise you for this time together in prayer. Help us to be people of prayer in this week to come, to set our will before your will, to set before your throne of grace all of our joys and our concerns. Thank you for this time together in prayer, and we ask all things in the everlasting name of our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you. With joyful and thankful hearts, we come before the Lord now with our tithes and our offerings.
All good gifts come from you, Lord, and from these riches we bring this offering. Help us to use it to further your work in our congregation and our town and further, while spreading the good news of your saving grace. Amen. Just join in praise book song, In Christ Alone.
Thank you.
may be seated. This morning's Old Testament lesson is from Deuteronomy chapter 4, verses 35 to 40, on page 153 in your pew Bible. You were shown these things so that you might know that the Lord is God. Besides him, there is no other. From heaven, he made you hear his voice to discipline you. On earth, he showed you his great fire, and you heard his words from out of the fire. Because he loved your ancestors and chose their descendants after them, he brought you out of Egypt by his presence and his great strength to drive out before you nations greater and stronger than you and to bring you into their land to give it to you for your inheritance as it is today. Acknowledge and take to heart this day that the Lord is God in heaven above and on earth below. There is no other. Keep his decrees and commands, which I am giving you today, so that it may well go well with you and your children after you, and that you may live long in the land your Lord, the Lord your God, gives you for all time. Amen.
Our New Testament lesson for today comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 12 through 28. We hear these words of the Apostle Paul on the resurrection of the dead. But if it is preached that Christ has been raised from the dead, how can some of you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? If there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. More than that, we are found to be false witnesses about God, for we have testified about God that he raised Christ from the dead, but he did not raise him if in fact the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile and you are still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, we are of all people most to be pitied. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead comes also through a man. For as in Adam all die, and so in Christ all will be made alive, but each in turn, Christ the first fruits, then, when he comes, those who belong to him. Then the end will come when he hands over the kingdom to God the Father after he has destroyed all dominion, authority, and power. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. For he has put everything under his feet. Now when it says that everything has been put under him, it is clear that this does not include God himself, who put everything under Christ. When he has done this, then the Son himself will be made subject to him who put everything under him, so that God may be all in all. We give thanks to God for his word to us here today. Please join me in prayer. We praise you, O God, as we worship together for this time now in your word. We thank you for your word of scripture that directs us to your word of life, your word made flesh in Jesus Christ. We pray, O God, that your Holy Spirit would speak to us of our salvation that has come in Jesus Christ. We thank you, O God, that you have power over sin and death, and that you bring us from death to life through faith in Jesus Christ. Speak this truth to us, God of life. We pray all things in Jesus' name. Amen. I forgot to mention that our New Testament lesson is on page 990 in your pew Bible. We're going to look at that here today as we continue our Evangelism 101 study, considering the uniqueness of Jesus Christ here and that is ultimately found in his resurrection. It was 50 years ago that everything changed. There was one man who came and brought sweeping change into this land. Now, he was not very well known when he arrived locally, but great power came with him. Before Franco Harris, Art Rooney said, we rarely won, But after he got here, we rarely lost. And so it's in just a few weeks now that the Steelers will retire his number 32 on that anniversary of the Immaculate Reception. And we're reminded of winning and a change in culture that came with the coming of Franco Harris that seemed to bring change to everything. This morning, we're talking about our God who changes everything in the resurrection of Jesus Christ as we consider Jesus as the God among many gods. The uniqueness of Jesus Christ being fully human and fully divine is seen throughout his life in the prophecy that leads up to his birth, his virgin birth, how he comes into the world throughout his ministry, in his death, and ultimately in his resurrection. We talk about the resurrection of Jesus so frequently that we forget how crucial it is to our Christian faith. The Apostle Paul gives us the most detailed teaching on the resurrection of the dead here in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Paul begins the chapter here by listing all of the people who have seen the resurrected Christ. And he lists himself last as he encounters the risen Christ on the road to Damascus, as that's recorded in Acts chapter 9, as he's en route to persecute the church and undo the early church there. Of course, his life is transformed and he becomes the apostle to the Gentile after his encounter with the resurrected Christ. And so the Lord Jesus, in his resurrected form, has transformed Paul's life and has transformed the lives of those who have come to faith in him as well. So Paul offers us two thoughts here on the resurrection of Jesus Christ and the hope that we have in his resurrection here in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 12 through 28. The first is that resurrection is real. Second is that Jesus controls eternity. First, resurrection is real as we look at verses 12 through 19 here. The wording of 1 Corinthians chapter 15 seems very cumbersome to us, and it seems confusing today as we read through it. But it's an example of what is known as Pauline rhetoric. It was a common writing style used by Paul in his letters. It was also used by philosophers in the Greco-Roman world, and the people of Corinth were influenced by those philosophers. They would have expected and understood Paul's use of this rhetoric here in his writing to them. And Paul's use of this rhetorical style tells the Corinthians that his teaching is important. So Paul begins by questioning the Corinthians, that if they believe that Jesus has been raised from the dead, how can they say there's no resurrection of the dead? So Paul then says if there's no resurrection of the dead, then Jesus himself has not been raised from the dead. And if this is true, then everything we say and believe about Jesus is false. If Jesus has not been raised from the dead, we're lying about God and about his ability to raise Jesus from the dead. So if no one is raised from the dead, then Jesus has not been raised from the dead either. And if Jesus has not been raised from the dead, then our faith in Jesus is useless because this means that he has not provided full atonement for our sins. Those who have lived in faith that have already died and now await the resurrection are simply dead if Jesus has not been raised from the dead. Paul says that if we only have faith in Jesus for this life, we have no hope, that our hope is in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So as Paul states the reality of the resurrection here, the resurrection of Jesus and our hope that we have in our resurrection from the dead, it reminds us that Jesus raises us to new life. Paul's writing here to address those in the Corinthian church who denied the resurrection of the dead. This stems from the teaching of Greek philosophers who believed that the body itself was evil and that death does us a favor by freeing us from the evil of our physical body. Paul addresses a certain false teaching here that plagues the early church and has snuck into Corinth here, and that is Gnosticism. It teaches that there's no connection between the physical and spiritual world. But we see this as true in the resurrection of Jesus Christ, that he was physically raised from the dead. But Gnosticism tells us that only our spiritual lives are important. and that there's a secret knowledge that allows us to unlock our salvation. But God's salvation has been revealed to everyone for all time in the life and death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's the only sign that we need, and that speaks to God's plan of salvation now and forever. So as we believe that Jesus has been raised from the dead, we know that faith in Jesus Christ raises us to new and everlasting life with him. Jesus guarantees us eternal life, eternity with him. Every week we confess as part of our worship that we believe in the resurrection of the dead in the Apostles' Creed, in our own physical resurrection, not simply the resurrection of Jesus, we confess that as well, but we confess that we believe in the resurrection of the dead. But we are quick to forget about eternal things, that we get so busy with our everyday lives that we don't think about eternity with God. We think of faith as something to help us right here and right now, and nothing more than that. That's all we really want out of our faith. We need Jesus to get us through another day. We don't picture eternity with him. And this is where we start to become confused, that all religions can lead us to God by helping us live better lives, and that's what God wants for us after all, right? But living in faith is not a prescription for our lives that may or may not help or may work at times and not work at other times, that God has set us aside for eternity through faith in Jesus Christ, that Jesus guarantees for us eternal life in his presence, that Jesus has been raised from the dead and he will raise us from the dead, that he has power over death in his resurrection from the dead. Jesus guarantees for all who trust in him eternal life. Second here, as we consider the resurrection of Jesus and look forward to our resurrection, we know that Jesus controls eternity. Jesus is the Lord of our lives now and the Lord of all of eternity. Looking at verses 20 through 28 here, Paul proclaims that Jesus has definitely been raised from the dead. And he states that Jesus is the first fruits of those who have died, which means that all who believe in Jesus Christ will be raised to share in everlasting life with him. The dead will come back to life. God has the power to bring us from death to life through faith in Jesus Christ. Paul says that death comes to humanity through one man and through the disobedience of Adam, and that life comes to us through one man, through the obedience of Jesus Christ. That Jesus has been raised from the dead and will come back to raise everyone who believes in him from the dead as well. And since Jesus has been raised from the dead, we will be raised from the dead as well. The end of time will come with the return of the resurrected Christ when he returns to earth in final judgment. Jesus will then hand over the kingdom of God to his heavenly Father, to our heavenly Father, after he has destroyed all opposition to him. The final enemy that Jesus has and that we have is death. Paul quotes from Psalm 8, verse 6, when he says that Jesus has put everything under his feet. He has dominion over all things. That Jesus is the one who can live in perfect obedience to the will of God, and he's the only one who's able to do so. When Jesus returns, we're told what it will look like when Jesus puts to rest our final enemy of death in Revelation chapter 21, verse 4. That he will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. Jesus will come to bring a new heaven and a new earth at his second coming. Jesus lives today at the right hand of the Father, that he lives in his resurrected body, waiting to be sent again by the Father. When he returns, this will bring the reign of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit to earth forever, for all time. The new heaven and new earth will come with the return of Jesus Christ. As Jesus comes to bring us with God for all of eternity, we know that only Jesus can provide us with our salvation, that only God in the person of Jesus Christ has the power over life and death. Our Old Testament lesson from Deuteronomy chapter 4 speaks of the uniqueness of the Lord, the God of Israel, that there's no other God that compares to him. God's people of Israel are preparing to enter the promised land after years of wandering in the wilderness, and God desires for his people to live in an intimate relationship with him. They need that now. They need that in the promised land. The death and resurrection of Jesus Christ fulfills that covenant that he's always going to be with his people and will never leave them, that God has come to us in Jesus Christ to bring us salvation for the purpose of dying for our sin and being raised from the dead to restore our relationship with God that's been broken by our disobedience. We give thanks to our God who alone can restore our relationship with him, that only Jesus can provide us with our salvation. Because this is true, we have an urgent message for the world around us. As the church of Jesus Christ, we have work that is eternally significant. No one else can make that claim. No other religion in the world can make that claim. No other group makes that claim. Only the church of Jesus Christ has good news that will last forever. Everything that we do as the church and as disciples of Jesus Christ should be motivated by that, that we have work that is eternally significant to tell other people who Jesus is. We have the only way that we can live forever with God through the good news of Jesus Christ. It's through believing that Jesus died on the cross and is raised from the dead that allows us to live with God forever. Our world tells us that you can do enough good to outweigh the bad things in your life, but according to God, that means nothing eternally. It's only through believing that Jesus paid the price for our sin that our relationship with God can be restored. No one can be good enough to make themselves right before God. There's no amount of money you can pay. We don't even have the proper currency to repay our debt to sin that we have with God. Only Jesus is able to do that. And this is an urgent message that we have for the world around us. All of us are called to proclaim this good news, to tell people who are dying that they can have life and life everlasting through faith in Jesus Christ. We're thankful for the work of the Holy Spirit in our lives that speaks faith to us, that allows us to live in the saving faith of Jesus Christ, and we trust that the Holy Spirit is at work in the lives of others to speak faith into their hearts as well. We know that God's salvation and God's power has been revealed here in the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and the resurrection is real, that God has the power to bring the dead back to life. We see that Jesus is raised from the dead 3 days after his death on the cross, and that we will share in his resurrection when he returns. That Jesus raises all of us to new life as we trust in him. Jesus guarantees for us eternal life, life now and life everlasting in his presence. That's guaranteed in his resurrection. Jesus, because he has conquered death, has power over all of eternity. That's given to him by his heavenly Father. Only Jesus can provide us with salvation because he died for our sins and has now conquered death. This is an urgent message that we have to proclaim to our loved ones, our neighbors, our friends, everyone that we know that doesn't know Jesus. We need to tell them who Jesus is, what he has done for us, and how we're able to live with God forever through faith in Jesus Christ. We trust that the Holy Spirit will use all of us to do the work of God's kingdom, that God will give us the courage to tell others who Jesus is. So tell someone and pray for them. Pray that the Lord will place one person on your heart here in this week and the weeks to come to tell them who Jesus is, that Jesus has conquered death to bring us new life now and forever. Let's pray. We thank you, O God, for your great power, your power that conquers sin and death. We thank you for the Lord Jesus and for his rule over all of creation. We pray, O God, that you speak that truth into our heart now, that you would give us the courage to live and proclaim that truth here in this week to come. Guide us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Our closing hymn for us this morning is He Lives. Please stand. Now receive this benediction. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you this day and forevermore. Amen.